before starting, yeah, I wanted to tell you that there are two books that I recommend around the topics of today. There is a book which was finished last year by Yvonne Choquet-Bruat at the age of 91. I mean, she's the only person I know who discussed with Einstein because she was the first one to prove the existence of solution of Einstein's equations containing propagation by waves. And this is an excellent book for students, but very rigorous also, but with physics. And more on the precise topic, this is the first volume of the excellent book of Michele Maggiore. Michele is now finishing his second volume on the more experimental part. Anyway, this is the first volume more on the theory. Okay, so here I have reminded you that in 1916, actually in November 1915, Einstein, for this part with some help with, from Hilbert, found the general action for matter coupled to gravity. And just for people who had by accident never seen that, so let me remind you, I will use a convention with the signature mostly plus. The letter G here denotes the minus the determinant of the metric of a pseudo-Riemannian spacetime. So the definition of the curvature of spacetime is given the metric tensor. You have this combination of partial derivative of the metric, which is the Levi-Civita connection. Then from it, you define the Riemann tensor and the contraction, which is the Ricci tensor. Einstein's equations on the left-hand side have the Einstein tensor, Ricci minus one half of the trace of R times the metric. And on the right-hand side, it has the functional derivative of the matter action with respect to G mu nu with the metric, which is the stress energy tensor of matter, okay? Just some conventions. Because I will, so the aim of the course is to go from these equations to the recent results, which are here, which is that it's in September 2015, the two LIGO detectors saw a noisy signal, and this signal is in excellent agreement with theoretical predictions. And the first theoretical prediction was an analytical prediction which was done here at IHES in 2000 with the method called effective one body that I will explain in detail, and how this method can predict not only this is the waveform emitted, so I will explain what is a gravitational wave from scratch, what is a waveform. This is the waveform as a function of time. In the effective one-body method, there is the first part, which is the in-spiral, when the two bodies are still well separated, and then they get closer and closer, and then the method defines a merger, and then attached to the signal, what happens after the two black holes coalesce together, which is, and I will explain how you construct that, the so-called ring down. So this was the first prediction 5 years before numerical relativity existed and 15 years before experiment existed to detect them. And but this has been later refined after the existence of numerical relativity simulation. NR means numerical relativity. Both our group here with Alessandro Naga and the group of Alessandra Buonanno in the States defined improved version of the effective one-body waveform, which extracted some information from numerical relativity. And here there is a sketch of the fact that after this kind of tuning of the analytic thing to numerical, there is an exquisite agreement between numerical relativity and effective one body. And these things have been used to extract this signal from the noise although there are other stages of extraction, this is these things that have been used to extract the masses, for instance. The fact that you say the masses are 29 and 36 is because you have fitted to something that depended continuously on two parameters, and then you maximize the overlap. So the aim of the course will be to go. So now let me explain some basic things before entering some technical details. So after creating generativity in November 1915, okay, in June of 1916, a few months later, Einstein worked out the structure of gravitational waves. I mean, everybody knew that generativity was a theory that was generalizing kind of Maxwell equations, so there would be waves in them. There was no question there would be waves. The question was, what was the structure of these waves, and what was the amount of generation of these waves by matter? Actually, the first paper by Einstein of 1916 is flawed. It has a mistake which is not a minor mistake. And the full correct answer essentially was given in 1918. And in this paper also, Einstein gave a formula giving the amount of energy emitted by moving masses, which depends on a certain time derivative of the quadrupole moment of the system. And but what I want to describe is that starting from this work, it is after the 1980s, okay, that all the modern methods that led to these things were developed, okay? And so I will mention, so there are two types of works that started in the 1980s. One work was about the dynamics of binary systems. So the course will be about what is the motion of two bodies with masses M1 and M2 that orbit around each other via the gravitational force, and what is the gravitational waves they emit, and what is the back reaction of the gravitational wave emission on the motion, and then what is the final signal of emission taking into account back reaction and the coalescence of these two objects when they are black holes. And I will not discuss the case where neutron stars. So the history of the dynamics of two-body systems in general relativity started in 1917 when Lorentz and Drost computed the first approximation beyond Newton's law. So at zeroth order, you know two bodies should attract each other by a 1 over r square law, Newton. But then you have corrections due to general relativity, corrections proportional not only to the square of the velocity divided by the velocity of light, but also due to nonlinear effects. And this was first worked out by Lorentz and Drost, and then later by Einstein in Field of Pine for 1938. The next approximation, so this is the approximation V over C square. The next approximation, V over C 4 and together with V over C 5, was first worked out, so it's 2 and 2.5 pn, in 1981, 1982, by Nathalie Derriel, who is here, and by me. Then the next approximation, 3 pn, which means V over C to the 6, was first computed by Yaranovsky, Schaefer, and myself in 2000. And at the time when we had finished this work, I thought this would be enough, and that was complicated enough. In the meantime, Mathematica existed, and then computer-aided algebraic calculation were made possible. After this, I really thought that was the end, but Piotr Yaranovsky is very enterprising. And then in 2014, yes, so Yaranovsky, Schaefer, and myself, we got the 4 pn for the first time, the 4 pn approximation, which is V over C to the power 8. And these ingredients are important ingredients for the story. There is another, so this is the ingredients about the equations of motion of a binary system. Another very important ingredient is the generation formalism. And the best the formalism for generating gravitational waves, and the best formalism is the so-called Blanchet-Damour higher formalism, which started a little bit before I came here when I worked with Blanchet, who was my PhD student, and then which was improved when Balla-Ayer came here in 1989, when just I arrived. So I will explain what is this formalism. And this formalism is what allows one to compute things there. So all these things is post-Newtonian work. So this uses post-Newtonian theory, which means, in a general physics language, perturbation theory. So this is, you use expansion in a small parameter. And the small parameter essentially is the velocity of the orbital velocity divided by the velocity of light. But in the coalescence of two black holes, the ratio V over C becomes 1/2 at the end, at merger. So the small parameter disappears, okay? And the approximation gets bad before you reach merger. And this is why I will explain that there was another layer, which is to go beyond perturbation theory, to use resummation technique. And this is within this thing that one of the most efficient and accurate thing created in 1999-2000 was the EUB, formalism that I will describe in detail. Now, so this is essentially the plan of the course. Now, let me remind basic facts at lowest order, that is to say, things that were known in the 60s before this work began. And the basic findings I have in mind is the work of Peters and Matthews. So there are two papers, Peters and Matthews in 64, and a paper of Peters alone in 1964. Now, what they did is they used the lowest order approximation that Einstein had worked out in 1918, that I will describe, which says that the waveform, the gravitational wave emitted by a binary, by any system, but let's say by a binary system, is proportional to the second time derivative of the quadrupole moment of the system. So if the system moves around, its quadrupole moment varies in time, and then you have a gravitational wave emitted. And then Einstein gave a formula saying that the energy, the flux of energy emitted at infinity is, so this is modulo maybe a factor two that Einstein got wrong, but conceptually he got it right, so it's just maybe an oversight. The amount of energy per unit time emitted as a flux at infinity in the forms of gravitational waves is there is a certain factor with Newton's constant. Yeah, I did not say G is Newton's constant, C the velocity of light. The third derivative of the quadrupole moment of the system square. Evidently, all over, I will use Einstein summation convention each time there is an index repeated. So the square means you put this thing twice, you sum over the indices I and J between 1 and 3. Peters and Matthews added to this the loss of angular momentum in the system in the form of gravitational waves at infinity. And they got a similar formula, which contains 2g over 5c5. The antisymmetric Levi-Civita symbol, which means epsilon ijk is plus 1 if ijk is even permutation of 1, 2, 3, and minus 1 if it is odd permutation of 1, 2, 3. And then here you have the second time derivative of the quadrupole moment and the third time derivative with some indices contracted this way. Then they heuristically assume that if you lose energy in angular momentum at infinity, this energy in angular momentum will be taken from the system, and therefore that a binary system going on elliptic orbit, so you have two bodies going around their center of mass, going like that, one going like that, and the other one going like that, that the energy and angular momentum of this system, mechanical energy, will be drained out of the system because of the fluxes at infinity. So you write that you have losses of energy equal to the fluxes at infinity. I should say that this is because of this indirect reasoning that you say the system loses energy to gravitational waves, therefore the system should pay for it, that people say that the observation of binary pulsars that have checked these are indirect proofs of the existence of gravitational radiation. Actually, in our work with Nathalie, we have done a direct calculation that I will not describe today of the interaction in space-time of two bodies, including nonlinear effects of gravity. So something which never talks about waves emitted at infinity, but which says that it takes a certain time for the interaction to propagate from one body to the other body, because it propagates with the velocity of light in Einstein theory. So it's a wave, it's a retarded wave. And this retardation in the calculation gives an extra term in the equations of motion, and then from this extra term, actually, you recover this. So you don't need to be heuristic. This is this is directly linked to the fact that gravity propagates at the velocity of light. So then Peters and Matthews use the relation between the energy of the system, like for instance, and the angular momentum of the system. Let me just write that the energy of the system is related when I have two masses to the semi-major axis of the relative orbit between the two by a formula of this type, a similar formula for the angular momentum. Then you write that the time derivative of this, therefore the time derivative of the semi-major axis, should be equated to minus this. You compute the average of this, you compute what is the quadrupole moment of a binary system. At the end, you get explicit formulas saying, so two formulas. The first formula, yeah, I should not have put this here. So let me put UB here. The first formula is that the orbital period of the system decreases secularly because the, let me write this, by Kepler's law, Kepler's third law, says that the total mass of the system is related to the orbital frequency, omega, where omega is 2 pi divided by the orbital period, so it's the orbital frequency, A is the semi-major axis. So this is the famous 1-2-3 law, where the mass is power 1, the orbital frequency is power 2, and the semi-major axis is power 3. And then this relates the period to A, but here you have the semi-major axis which is related to the energy, so you know the loss of energy. So finally you have the change of period. And again, with Nathalie we have shown directly, without using this reasoning, by a direct dynamical calculation, that indeed the propagation of gravity at the velocity of light implies a change of the period of a binary system, which in lowest approximation is given by an explicit formula, 192 pi over 5. By the way, the reason why there is a 1 over 5 in all those formulas is because the spin of the graviton is 2, it's helicity 2, and 2s plus 1, where with s equal 2, is 2 times 2 plus 1, so it's 5. That's why there is always these factors, 1 over 2s plus 1, which are like spin factors of the Lande Hall formula and things like that. Anyway, so then you have the actually the orbital frequency here, 2 pi over p, but it's p, so I put p, times Newton's constant to the 5/3. Then there is the product of the masses divided by the sum to the power 1/3. And then you have a certain function of eccentricity here, which is 1 because a binary system in general has eccentricity. E squared plus 37 over 96 E4 divided by 1 minus E squared to the 5 half. No, yes, 5 half. Now, this change of the orbital period of a binary system due to the wave propagation of gravity between the two objects has been verified experimentally to very high accuracy, 1 part in 1,000 in several binary pulsar systems. So we know this is real. And what are the consequences? The first consequences is that there is a minus sign, okay? So this is saying the system is going faster and faster. Okay, the orbital period is diminishing, which means the two objects get closer and closer. Because they are closer, they attract more each other, and then they go faster and faster. And this is why these things have been going on for 500 million years. You know, if you take two bodies separated by very large distances, they go around, but their orbital period decreases. They get closer and closer, so they go faster and faster. And at the end, when they are very, very close, they coalesce, they fuse to make a final object from the two things. This is what has been seen. This event happened, you know, a billion light years away. It's fantastic to be able to have seen it. It crossed the Earth. The time scale here is 0.2 seconds. So these are the last three orbits which have been seen. The last three orbits, it goes so fast, half the velocity of light, the last three orbits, you have two objects of 100 kilometers, they go around, so it's 0.1 second for one orbit at the end. But before, it existed for 100 million years, but we could not see it from the Earth. Now, what I wanted to say is, the first thing, we know that the orbital period will decrease. But from this other formula, due to Peters, the change of angular momentum will imply a change of eccentricity also. And when you work out the change of eccentricity, Peters was able to solve in lowest approximation how the eccentricity depends on the period, because you have differential equations like d by dt is a function of eccentricity and period, and you have dp over dt, which is a function, another function of eccentricity and period. But if you take the ratio of the two, you have a differential equation for e as a function of p. And actually, he was able to solve it. It's separable. And surprisingly, the solution is both simple and surprisingly complicated, because the exact solution at lowest order is that e squared divided by 1 minus e squared to the 19.6 times 1 plus 121 over 304 e squared to the power, this power is always really surprising. It's the power 145 divided by 121. I mean, how can simple things generate a power like that? And this thing is modulo constant depends, which depends on initial conditions, is proportional to the period to the power 19.9. Actually, these exact powers are not very important. What is important is, as I said, the orbital period decreases. It goes faster and faster. And therefore, the eccentricity, because there is e squared here, decreases. Even if you start with large eccentricity, it will decrease. And at the end, the eccentricity is small. So what you get is that e squared is proportional to a power of p. And therefore, as the period decreases, the eccentricity decreases, which means that you have circularization. Actually, the circularization is rather effective. If you start with systems which are very elliptic, the losses of angular momentum first make them enlarge and wide systems. They stay wide, but they are nearly circular. Okay. And then, after being, so they get circular first. And then this circular thing gets smaller and smaller. So we have a spiral. Okay. And this is an important simplification, because one could do all those theory. Because at the end, the orbit is circular, so it simplifies many things, and one can compute high order things because it is a circular orbit. Okay. If I go at this pace, I will never finish things. So I've already shown, now we'll go faster. Some technical things. So let me solve now gravitational waves at linearized approximation. So I solve Einstein's equations at linearized approximation. This means what? One assumes that G mu nu, the curve spacetime metric, is the flat eta mu nu denotes the Minkowski metric, diagonal minus plus 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 on the diagonal. Yeah, most of what I will do will be in four dimensions. Here I've written Einstein's equation in spacetime dimension D. You see that in any dimension there is one half here on the left, but when you put it on the right, there is the dimension which comes in. It's only in spacetime D equal 4 that on the right-hand side you have also minus one half, okay? But I will be in D equal 4 most of the time. And then you have a perturbation in spacetime of this curve metric, and you assume that h mu nu is small compared to 1. This is plus 1 minus 1, so h mu nu is dimensionless. Now you take this formula, you compute things, you plug this here, it's very easy, you have dh, you can take this eta to lowest order, then gamma is linear in derivative of h, then you plug here, Riemann and Ricci contains two derivatives of h mu nu, okay? When you write explicitly the linearized Einstein tensor, I will do like Hugo, okay. You find there is a one half, because there is this one half, there is no one half here. And then you find that this is minus the D'Alembertian of h mu nu. D'Alembertian means a flat D'Alembertian, okay? So it is eta mu nu, d mu nu, where d mu nu means the partial derivative repeated with respect to x mu, x nu. Then you have a second term with the same sign, minus, which is d mu nu h, where h means the trace eta mu nu of h mu nu, okay, or eta alpha beta h alpha beta summed. And then you have two terms, two extra terms, h alpha nu plus d nu alpha h alpha mu, where the index alpha is raised by the flat Minkowski metric. Now linearize, so in empty space, you look for solution of at linearized approximation of Ricci equals zero, because when I have no matter, this form of Einstein equations tell me it's Ricci flat. And now there are two ways of solving, and that's what Einstein did in 1916 and 1918. We want to find solution of these equations propagating as waves in empty space. A simple thing is to immediately look for plane waves, that is to say. You say, okay, let me, like Maxwell equations, look for solutions where this is a function of x, I have an amplitude, which is a tensorial amplitude, and then I have kx, where kx means k lambda x lambda. Okay, so it means, if I decompose in space and time, it means kx minus omega t, okay? So it is a phase factor of a wave with the k spatial frequency and omega the circular time frequency. And you plug this here. So immediately, saying that this is equal to zero tells you that you get the equation. So this gives k square. Yeah, where k square means eta mu nu, k mu, k nu, okay? You move everything with things, so the block operator gives k square, a mu nu, plus k mu, k nu, a, where a denotes the trace, so again it is eta mu nu, a mu nu, and then you have the other terms, which are minus k mu, k lambda, a nu lambda, minus k nu, k lambda, a mu lambda. Everything equal to zero. Okay, but now how do you solve that? First, you say, let's assume if k square, which means this, okay, were different from zero, I could solve for mu nu from this equation. So I will get mu nu equal 1 over k square of what? I would get something like mu nu. I have k mu b nu plus k nu b mu, with b mu is this times this, plus one half of this. Okay, I will get a combination of this type. But now we have to remember that Einstein's equations are invariant under all coordinate transformations. And therefore, the linearized Einstein equations are also invariant under infinitesimal coordinate transformations taken around flat space. So if I take an infinitesimal coordinate transformation, change of coordinates from x mu to x prime mu, this is a xi. So okay, you find that the effect on a linearized gravity is that the metric changes by h mu nu minus d mu xi nu minus d nu xi, is a better one, xi mu. If I am in the realm of plane waves, that is to say, if I do a coordinate transformation which is also wave-like, this means, like for instance, if xi mu is equal to, you know, how did I denote it? If it is eta mu exponential ikx, then this thing will be minus I k mu eta nu minus I k nu eta mu. And therefore, a change of coordinate has the effect of a gauge transformation on h mu nu, which is of the type k mu a vector plus k nu the same vector. But we have found here that if k square is different from zero, a mu nu would be of this type. Therefore, any waves which does not propagate with the velocity of light is of this type, which is a coordinate wave. It's not a real wave. And therefore, necessarily, the waves must propagate with the velocity of light. So this is a simple way of saying we must have, for gravitational waves, k square equals zero. Okay? But now, once you have k square equals zero, otherwise this is not a real wave, it's an artifact of changing coordinate system, the same equation tells me more. That is to say, not only it propagates with the velocity of light, but I must have these conditions. To write these conditions, I will define two things. Given any tensor, I define h bar mu nu like h mu nu minus 1/2 the trace of this tensor with eta times eta mu nu, okay, with the minus 1/2. Okay? And in particular, a bar mu nu is a mu nu minus 1/2 a, the trace of a mu nu, times eta mu nu. If I use just this definition, these two terms simplify, now k square equals zero, and then I get the condition that zero is equal to k lambda times a bar mu lambda, which is, so I get the first condition for gravitational waves, k square equals zero, and the second condition. So the first condition says they propagate with the velocity of light. The second condition tells me it's a transversality condition, because it says that the contraction of the amplitude, slightly modified, with the vector of propagation in spacetime is zero. So it's a transversality condition. But now I can do so this is one way of getting plane waves. There is another way that I will not do in detail, but just mention, which is, before solving Einstein's equations directly, here I have not chosen any coordinate system. By the way, there is something surprising here, which is that even if you don't fix the coordinate system at all, if you have waves, they must satisfy this condition, which is characteristic of a special way of fixing coordinates, which is called the harmonic gauge. So the other proof is to go to harmonic coordinates, which is to change the coordinate system of this type, to solve an equation for xi mu of the type something such that the following condition is satisfied, d lambda h bar mu lambda equals zero. You can show in general that it is always possible, independently of saying that I discuss waves, okay, I can fix the coordinate gauge that I use in Einstein equation by this condition. When you do that, you recognize that these two terms, actually, because here you can write this is twice 1/2,
And then you put one half here and one half here, and you find that these two terms are actually this. Now I can absorb this term. And therefore, if this is zero, these two terms disappear. And then in this harmonic coordinate system, the linearized Ricci tensor is minus one half d'Alembert de H mu nu. This is analogous to considering Maxwell equations. If you take Maxwell equations, you know, d nu f mu nu equals zero in vacuum with f mu nu d mu a nu minus d nu a mu. So then you have an extra d mu. Maxwell equations, they become minus d'Alembert of a mu plus d mu of the divergence. So it's very similar to this. If I go to the Lorentz gauge, and by the way, apparently this Lorentz is not the famous Lorentz. It's supposed to be a Lorentz without T. Anyway, in Lorentz gauge, where this is zero, then in Lorentz gauge, Maxwell's equation become the field equation is minus d'Alembert of A mu, equal the source, let's say, if there is a source, and nothing if you have no source. And you have the condition d mu A mu equals zero. So you see, Einstein equations are very similar with one index more. Okay, so this is well known. Now, what is the structure of gravitational waves here? I can still do something because I said if I do a coordinate transformation, I have this effect. I said here, I can, I have already used the coordinate transformation to simplify things, but I can still do another coordinate transformation because if I do a second coordinate transformation, let's say psi prime mu in addition to the one I did before, and if this psi prime is a wave-like satisfied d'Alembert equals zero, then I will not change the condition before. And you can check that this thing is invariant under a coordinate transformation if the coordinate transformation propagates with the velocity of light. So I can further reduce this solution. And a nice way is to go to so-called TT, transverse traceless gauge. Now let me write gravitational waves in transverse traceless gauge. This is a gauge where you impose that the 0, 0 and the 0i components, where 0 is the time coordinate, I is the space coordinate, are 0. And you only have the spatial components of a plane wave amplitude. And when you do that and you plug in this formula, this thing simplifies. You find immediately that the trace A must be 0, and therefore the spatial trace must be 0. So once you have imposed this, the spatial trace must be 0. And then the spatial tensor is transverse in the usual sense. That is to say, this is a tensor, and it is orthogonal when I contract it with respect to the direction of propagation in space of the gravitational wave. So this is a plane wave in transverse traceless gauge with the condition k squared equals 0. If I now make a superposition of these waves, so I, we are in France, we have the Fourier theorem, so any thing can be expanded in Fourier integrals. And so I recombine a general solution of Einstein's equation in vacuum, now h mu nu, and then in this gauge, if you, you find that in TT gauge, the 0, 0 by convention is 0, as well as the 0i component. The only components that exist are the ij component, but their trace is 0 also. And the equations of propagation are first a transversality condition. This condition becomes, when I consider for a general function of x, this transversality. And this condition becomes that d'Alembert of hij tt equals 0. Okay, so this is what a wave, a gravitational wave, looks like. Now let me, actually I can use this blackboard now. So in practical terms, what it means is that if I consider a wave which propagates in the direction k, then which will be the z-axis, okay, when we take some axis. Then I have a plane, so let's say this is the z-axis. Then I have a plane orthogonal to this, which is an xy plane. Gravitational waves has only components in the xy plane. So in that sense, the wave itself is only is transverse. And so let me write that k is k times the unit vector Ez. Then hijtt, which is now it's a 3x3 matrix. Hij has two special indices. And it is a function of t and z in that case for a plane wave. If I look at the amplitudes, then it will have, because of the transversality condition, all those things that contain a z index will be zero. I will have only xx, yy, and xy, but this is symmetric, and the trace must be zero, which means the sum of this, this, and this is zero. So it means I have one thing here, I have minus the same thing here, and then I have something else there. So I have, and then I have the exponential. I write this just explicitly so that you see what it means. Plus complex conjugate, because we are interested in real solution of Einstein's equation, and the Fourier modes are complex. Which means that this waves has a component here as a function of t of z when I reconstruct this. Htz, tz, and minus h plus tz. So these symbols here, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, means plus and cross. So these are so-called two linear polarization of a gravitational waves. This is analogous to the fact that when I have a Maxwell electromagnetic wave, I can go not only in Lorentz gauge, but in a gauge where A0 is 0. One can further impose this. I have only AI, which must be transverse also. And then when the wave propagates in the z direction, an electromagnetic wave has only the component AX, AY, and 0. So let me write the first thing. Yeah. So here I have AX, AY, 0, and then exponential IKX plus CC. And explicitly, this means I have AX as a function of T and Z, AY a function of T and Z, and 0. So gravitational waves is very similar to an electromagnetic waves in the sense that there are only two independent functions given a wave propagating in some direction. I have two arbitrary data that I give, this one and this one, like, and it is transverse, like an electromagnetic waves. But there is a big difference. And the big difference, to see it, you need to define helicity amplitudes. This is a name, but we are going to understand why. And helicity amplitudes means taking a linear combination of the two amplitudes with a complex coefficient. Okay? So in electromagnetism, you define a helicity amplitude for plus one or minus one helicity. And the definition is AX. And because of some convention, when there is a plus here, you need to put a minus, but it's just a convention. So you take the complex combination of the two amplitudes. If you do the same thing for gravity, you define an amplitude called with a 2 instead of a 1, which is these amplitudes, okay, with the same combination. So it is A of the gravity wave minus or plus IA, the other thing. And now the fact is that, so here we have two mathematical objects, which are waves living in the plane XY orthogonal to the propagation of the wave. I can do still, I can act on this wave by rotation, either in the plane. I can, leaving fixed the direction z, I can rotate the coordinate system or rotate the wave, it depends if you are passive or active. When you do that, if you rotate the coordinate system by an angle theta, you find that this thing, the electromagnetic one, will, because so there will be cosine and sine, okay? But now I have taken complex combination, and by Demoivre formula, I will have an exponential. So you find that this is exponential plus or minus I theta the helicity amplitude for electromagnetism with a coefficient 1 here. Why, if you do that for gravity, you find that A plus or minus 2 for gravity after rotation is exponential plus or minus 2 I theta A plus or minus 2. So this is saying that the mathematical object which represents the gravitational wave in the transverse plane, when you rotate by an angle theta, it turns by an angle 2 theta, while an electromagnetic wave turns by an angle 1 theta. Okay, and this is, in general, if something rotates by exponential IS theta, you say that it has helicity S. Okay? So this is just a simple, without doing quantization of the thing, saying that the helicity of gravitational waves is plus or minus 2, while the helicity of electromagnetic waves is plus or minus 1. Let me move this up. Apparently, in the old days, at the time of Poincaré, when Poincaré was giving lectures, there was an assistant that was erasing things all the time. Autre temps, autre honneur. Okay, so this was the helicity of the gravitational wave. Now I want to very briefly mention the fact that, two things. When I have an electromagnetic wave, finally the object that represents the wave is made of a vector in the plane transverse to the propagation, so in the xy plane. So in this plane, I have coordinate system xy, and then the object I talk about is a vector. And now if you compute at one point of space, this vector is a sum of exponential I omega t and things like that. So it's so it rotates, okay? It is a sum of cosine and sine. And then you find that AX, AY, which are these two components, they draw in general an ellipse. If you take the real part of the two, well, you have two helicities, you have two complex numbers. So you have a wave is described by two complex numbers, A plus 1 and A minus 1. In general, if these two complex numbers do not have the same magnitude, are not proportional to each other or whatever, you have an ellipse. So this is saying this is an elliptically polarized electromagnetic waves. If you do the same thing for gravity, actually, you have essentially the same thing, because here you can consider the object. So here, this we can say this is a complex plane. So this arrow in the complex plane is AX plus I AY. With a gravitational waves, you can do the same thing. You can take H plus, but H plus meant what? It meant HXX. It's the XX component. This is minus, it's YY, which is minus HX, and this is a HXY. So you take, you can take these things. This is a real quantity, this is a real quantity. So now I have a complex quantity. And in general, it is a combination of A plus 2 and A minus 2. And then, again, you have an elliptic. You have an ellipse, really, in this plane. It's a Lissajou simple thing, which is an ellipse. But you have special cases. Like if for instance, one of the two helicity amplitude is 0, you find that this becomes a circle. Okay. On the other hand, if the two things are proportional as complex numbers to each other, you will have a line. You will have the ellipse will degenerate in a line. So this is called a linearly polarized waves. This would be a circularly polarized wave, and the general condition is an elliptically polarized wave. So it's exactly the same thing as for electromagnetism. I mean, visually at least, except there is this factor 2 floating around. Let me also mention something. Let me go back to space-time. Here I was in space to say I have the direction k of propagation, let's call it z, and then I have the plane xy. If you are more Minkowskian, you can say, okay, a wave, a gravitational wave is described by what? And an electromagnetic wave also. It's described by, first, the k vector, k mu, which is the wave vector of the wave, which is on the light cone. So I have k mu, okay? And now if I have an electromagnetic wave, I have an amplitude, a mu, which is orthogonal to k mu. So this means that I must consider the plane orthogonal, the plane orthogonal to the light cone is also tangent to the light cone, sorry. If I take the hypersurface orthogonal to a null vector, k mu is null, k square equals zero, is isotropic, as one said in French in the old days. The plane orthogonal to k mu is also the plane tangent, hyperplane tangent. Here I am in 3+1 dimension, you need to add one dimension, okay? And now I know that an electromagnetic wave is described by some polarization vector, which is orthogonal, okay? With epsilon mu k mu equals zero, and then the electromagnetic wave would be a mu equal, let's say, some amplitude, epsilon mu epsilon ikx. In particular, I can take a complex, this is a two, there are two vectors orthogonal, I am in a four space-time dimension, so this is a three-dimensional hypersurface, and the set of vectors, here there are three vectors, there is a k mu is orthogonal to itself, and then I have two more vectors. So I can choose, for instance, epsilon mu is, I can take a basis and of two vectors A1 and A2, which are orthogonal, k dot A1 equals zero, like k dot E2. So I take two vectors orthogonal to k, and such that they have units magnitude, equal one, equal A2 square, and that they are orthogonal to each other. Okay, it's just a basis, okay? Now let me take a particular polarization vector, which corresponds to a circular polarization. So if I take this combination, it is a circularly polarized electromagnetic waves. Now, why am I saying that? I'm saying that because if you do the same thing with gravity, with the same polarization, complex polarization epsilon mu, you can construct also a circularly polarized gravitational wave, which is simply an amplitude coefficient times epsilon mu, AKX in space-time. Okay, and then, therefore, you see that the polarization tensor of a gravitational wave in this simple thing is just the product of two electromagnetic waves. And this thing plays a role in string theory, and the fact that in string theory, and now also in quantum field theory, gravity is like the square of electromagnetism. Actually, you can see it already at the level of plane waves. Now, to finish the first hour, there will be a 15-minute break. Let me say that here I have done really the naive things, a linearized first-order small wave propagating around a flat background, because the mathematics is easier. We are interested, this wave here, which has been observed last September, was emitted a billion light years away and then traveled in a cosmological space-time. It had to pass through galaxies and things like that in a curved space-time. This is not flat space between us and this thing. So the full theory of gravitational waves it has to combine two things. Locally in a system around the source, you can use flat space-time calculation, but then when the wave propagates far in space-time, you have to use another technique. And the way to do that is to compute gravitational waves in curved space, is to use the WKB or high frequency approximation, which means that a general gravitational wave, you can say, is a space-time, which is the sum of a background space-time which only contains like slow frequencies, like something which varies on cosmological times or galactic times. And then you add to it a small wave, so with a coefficient epsilon, which will also have, it's a two-time method, that is, it also varies with the slow time scale, but it varies with a fast time scale. So you introduce like a fast varying phase, which means you take a large parameter, one, and then you look for a solution of Einstein equation of this type as, as approximation in inverse powers of omega, a WKB approximation, okay? And when you do that, actually, it's subtle because it depends how small is epsilon compared to the omega. If omega is first order in 1/1, if epsilon is first order or second order in 1/1 omega, it changes the back reaction of this wave on this. But for this, I refer you to the recent book of Yvonne Choquet-Bruyat, because indeed, this is something that Yvonne Choquet-Bruyat herself worked as a research paper long ago, and this is carefully explained in her book. So let us stop now for a break. Okay, so now that Yvonne Choquet-Bruyat is with us, person who first proved mathematically the existence of exact solution of Einstein's equations, including domain of dependence, which means gravitational wave propagation, and who discussed with Einstein in 1952 in Princeton. Now let me go to multipolar. So now I will enter more technical details. In order to be able to compute things to high accuracy, we need actually to go beyond. I reminded you that Einstein had worked out the lowest order so-called quadrupole approximation, and even the quadrupole approximation was done to lowest order in post-Newtonian expansion, but we are not going to reproach him not to have done the full thing. He left us something to do. And now I want to discuss the question of multipolar expansion in linearized gravity and surprisingly the in the time domain the first full correct discussion of multipolar expansions in linearized gravity was done by Bala Ayer and myself here in 91, she's wave D 91, following work that I will explain at length later by Blanchet and myself, Anal-Henri Poincaré, 89. So let me introduce, because I always consider, if you open a textbook, and even for electromagnetism, if you open a textbook, which means Jackson, and you look at multipolar expansion of electromagnetic fields, I consider it's a mess. I cannot understand what is going on. There are strange objects. You don't know what is going on. Actually, there is a way, and it is in the Fourier domain. That is to say, you don't even compute what is emitted by a time-varying source. You have to Fourier transform everything, and then you have Bessel functions. Actually, the work that was done by us, starting in 89-90, was in the time domain, and use a technical tool that Kip Thorne had suggested would be good, which is to use the symmetric trace-free Cartesian tensor representation of multipole expansions. So let me explain this. What is a multipole expansion? Multipole expansion is an expansion in irreducible representations of SO3. So don't let your mind block if you don't know what it is. I will explain what it means. So, and I will, if you have, for instance, if you have a field which is just a scalar field, but we will do the vector field and the tensor field, which satisfy a wave equation of this type with some source, okay, minus 4 pi. Source, but I consider the field outside the source so that it satisfies D'Alembert phi equals zero.
And I am interested in the retarded waves generated by the source. Okay. But the important thing is that this operator here is invariant under rotations in space. Okay, it's invariant under Moore, but as the source usually defines a certain tube, you can define an origin somewhere in space, which continues to exist in time. And then you are interested in rotations acting in space. Now, what does it mean this is invariant in space? It means that if I have a solution phi of this equation with zero in the right-hand side, and if I define, it's a function of time and space. And if I define a new function, phi prime, or phi with an index r of t and x, which is phi of t and r minus 1 of x, where r is it's an orthogonal matrix. It's a rotation in the usual sense, let's say an active rotation, active, which rotates points in space. You make it act with the inverse so that it is a good representation on the space of function. It's just a technical detail. The point is that if this function phi is a solution of number phi equals 0, this new function phi r for any orthogonal metric is again a solution of the same equation. Okay? Remember that here I'm really rotating the solution in the sense that if I look at a function phi, for instance, at a given t and r equal modulus of x as a function of angles n, so I define x equal rn, where r is the modulus, n is the unit vector on the unit sphere. So this becomes a function of the unit sphere. Like, for instance, there is a blob here and it is zero elsewhere. Rotation means I really rotate where the blob is, okay? So it's a different function. Now, if I continue considering this phi as a function of tr, let's say fixed, and the unit vector on the unit sphere, this becomes a function on the unit sphere. Now, any function on the unit sphere can be expanded in an infinite series labeled by an integer L going from 0 to infinity, to plus infinity, where such that each building block here is such that when I act on this by this operation, I rotate it, then this block here, rotated by r, navigates in a finite dimensional space with dimension 2L plus 1. Okay? That there is a vector space with finite dimension such that all the solutions, when I act with rotation, they are linear combination of some basis. So this is, and now let's be practical. What is a member of, and this is the irreducible representation of the group of rotations viewed on the sphere. And what is a practical way of parameterizing this thing, a function, so if I take now a function FL in this space as a function on the unit sphere, n is satisfies n square equal 1. I am in space. When I put an arrow, it means I have a three-dimensional Euclidean space, okay? Now, there are several ways of representing it, but a nice way is the STF way. It means I can parameterize a general element by a tensor with L indices, so I have I1, I2, up to IL, contracted with NI1, NI2, NIL. So it is something which is a polynomial of Lth order in the unit vector, constrained by this thing. And the hat means that this tensor is symmetric. So if I intervert, if I exchange indices, it does not change. And trace-free, if I take any trace on any pair of indices, it is zero, okay? So it's called STF, symmetric trace-free. It is relatively, and now if I act with the, if I act with the rotation R, let me put it as an action on the left acting on FL, what does it mean when I act on it? What it means is that I leave NI1, I can convert the action on this. That's why there is r minus 1. So then it means this tensor becomes a new tensor, IL, where f prime with L indices, IL,
is obtained by the rotation matrix I1, J1, etc., IL, JL, the original tensor, J1, JL.
Okay, so it acts on the tensor as a usual rotation, and the space of all these tensors is of dimension 2L plus 1. Now, which one can see in various ways. And this is, as I will explain later, this is equivalent to the YLMs, the usual multiple things, but the YLM confuse things because for the reasons I will explain. Now, a simple way of understanding why symmetric trace-free tensors enter in the game as a nice way of parameterizing this is to consider, for instance, not the Lambert equation, but Laplace equation, Laplace equal phi equal 0. And let me consider the general solution of Laplace equation in a ball, for instance, the unit ball with regular at the origin, but with some conditions on the boundary of the ball. And don't ask a mathematical question about that. Let me formally say this is an elliptic equation, so the solution is analytic, actually. And because it is analytic, I can write that phi at point x, separated from the origin, can be expanded in a power series, Taylor series, so it's phi of 0 plus xi, the derivative of phi at the origin, plus 1 half of xi xj dij phi plus 1 over factorial 3x, 3 derivatives, and things like that. Now, let me immediately introduce a convenient notation that we introduce with Luc Blanchet, which is that when I have a tensor with L indices, small l, you don't want to write always I1, I2, IL, okay? The only information which is useful is that there are L indices. And therefore, the convention is that you write just a capital L, okay? If it had P small indices, you would put the capital P. So it's just a symbol for saying there are L indices. And then the product of a vector, the same vector L times, you just denote it LL, NL. Okay, it's just a contracted notation, but it means L indices with the, so it's a generalized Einstein summation convention. Now you sum over multi indices. Okay? And now this thing can be written as sum over L from 0 to infinity of 1 over factorial L, because this is Taylor's formula, XL DL of phi 0, which means, again, so XL means X1, X2, up to L indices, and DL means a repeated derivative. But you see that this thing is a sum over L of XL, some object with L indices, FL, which is this divided by this. But this object is symmetric because it is a multi-derivative, and it is traceless because if I take the trace of any indices, as this is Laplace equals 0, it is 0. So this way, I have proven that the general solution inside the ball of phi can be indeed the general solution regular at the origin can be written this way. Now, I can also write it as sum over L. I can write the vector x is r the vector n. Okay. Therefore, this thing is r to the power l. I take the modulus in front. The vector n has a multi n1, n2, etc., ni1, ni2, nil, times dfl, okay? And now I can write the equation Laplace of phi equals 0, decomposing Laplace as a radial derivative plus 1 over r squared, the angular derivative acting on the angles theta phi on the sphere. That's the usual formula quantum mechanics for the Laplace, where this operator can be written either as 1 over r squared dr r squared dr, or as 1 over r dr squared r, or as dr twice plus 2 over r dr, okay? It's all equal to this. And now I know that this is the general solution of Laplace equals 0. So when you plug this information here, you find easily that this proves that the angular operator acting on NL, sorry, yes, I have to explain. This object, when I put a hat, it means symmetric trace-free. If I contract a symmetric trace-free by something else, it projects the other thing also symmetric trace-free,
Okay, so this thing is also, now I write it in symmetric trace tree to make it an irreducible component. Then I find that the angular operator acting on this, just by saying this is a solution of Laplace, I find this might be minus L, L plus 1, NL. Okay. Now that I have proven this, I can ask a different question. Let me find what is the general solution now of Laplace equals 0 between two shells, not regular at the origin, but between R1 and R2. I expand it, so what do? I expand it, I write phi equals sum over L of NL. I decompose it, so let me explain this better. When I write, let me write it, okay. I can write it this way. As a function on the unit sphere, I can decompose in a multipolar series in the symmetric trace-free projection of NL. This is equivalent to a YLM, a decomposition in spherical harmonics. Okay? When I do that and I use this equation, I write Laplace of phi equals 0, I get a differential equation for FL, and you find easily that this differential equation has two solutions. One, which is the well-known R to the plus L, which is regular at the origin, and the other one, which is 1 over R to the L plus 1. Indeed, L and minus L plus 1 are the two roots of S plus 1 equal L L plus 1. Okay, you find it's a second order equation for the power law, and okay, you know that. So the conclusion is that the general solution of Laplace equals 0 between two shells will be of this type, where this object FL of R, which is symmetric trace free in it, so it's a tensor with L indices and it's a function of R, but we just I just argued quickly that this function will be the sum of R to the L and 1 over R to the L plus 1. So this thing will be a certain symmetric trace free tensor, which is a constant, times R to the L plus another thing, which is d to d r to the minus l plus 1. Okay. Now, before I had only the first term because the other term is singular at the origin. Okay. So this is the general solution of Laplace equals 0 between two shells. And this is equivalent to, so let me write this. Now, let me consider the general solution of Laplace equation in vacuum, which is decaying at infinity. Now, I impose the other condition. I want something which is regular at infinity. Now, I need to cancel this term, because this term grows at infinity. Okay? So I keep only the other term. So just to understand what we are talking about. So this reasoning proves that the general solution of Laplace equals 0 which decays at infinity is the infinite series over L. By the way, this series on the sphere, they converge under weak conditions of differentiability, like being C2 on the sphere. I remember one day I discussed with Barry Simon, I was in Caltech when we were developing this, so I asked him, can I write this series? Do they converge, Barry? And they said, yeah, don't worry, so you are C2, it's okay. Anyway. Physicists don't care too much, but it's a weak condition. What does it mean, this thing, to the R L plus 1? If I write it explicitly, it means I have an object for L equals 0 which has no indices, so it is a constant, let's say D0, over R L plus 1, plus I have an object with one index, Ni over R square, plus I have an object with two indices which is symmetric and trace-free, Ni, Nj, let me write, what is Nij like that? It means Ni, Nj, symmetric trace-free. So it means Ni, Nj, I must take, it's symmetric already. So what I need is to take away the trace. So it's minus 1/3 delta Ij, because n squared equal to 1. So you see that the second term is 1 over R cube, plus etc. But this is the usual multipolar expansion, you know. This is the monopole, 1 over R. This is the dipole, di, a vector. This is a quadrupole, an object symmetric trace-free with
something there. So you recover the usual multipolar expansion. But one can write even better in the sense that there is a useful formula, which is that the Lth repeated derivative of 1 over r, okay? Without doing any calculation, what do we know about this? 1 over r satisfies Laplace of 1 over r equal minus 4 pi delta, but this means outside the origin, it's 0 outside the origin. So it is harmonic. If I take derivative of an harmonic function, it is again harmonic. Okay. So this thing will be, by dimensional analysis, 1 over r to the L plus 1, and is harmonic. Therefore, it must be one of the harmonic functions I have written there. And indeed, if you do a calculation, you just need to find what is the coefficient in front. It's minus to the L. By the way, yeah, I never understood why for 50 years when people write, they write always minus 1 to the power L. Okay, you don't need the 1. It's the sign minus to the power L, but it means, okay, just to simplify notations. So it's minus to the L. 2L minus 1 double factorial. What is a double factorial? A double factorial means you do only half of the thing. Like double factorial 5 is 5 times 3 times 1, okay? Double factorial 7 is 7 times 5, etc. Okay, you don't make, you make half of them. It should be a half factorial, but it is a double factorial. NL, which means the generalization of this with many indices. You take the product, you take away all traces, divided by r to the L plus 1. Okay? And therefore, modulo a change of notation by absorbing this factor in D, this thing can be written sum over L, slightly modified DL, which is still symmetric trace free, DL of 1 over r. Ah, but now we have something which is very easy to understand, because finally, a multipolar, the general solution of Laplace equals 0 outside the source is simply the repeated derivative of 1 over r, which is evidently harmonic, and it is symmetric trace free, with some tensor in front. And as this is symmetric trace free, the tensor is projected to be symmetric trace free. So this can be generalized, okay, to, yes, so now let us apply. So these are field multiples, in the sense I said, maybe I am discussing, I am now discussing this equation. Not Laplace equation, but Poisson equation, let's say, which means a source. And I put a minus 4 pi because I remember the delta, so I prefer to put the minus 4 pi there, and then I don't have to put it again. The green function, let me actually write this better. The green function for Laplace equation is 1 over x minus y, in the sense that this is equal to minus 4 pi delta function three-dimensional x minus y. Okay? Because of this, I can solve Poisson equation as Poisson discovered long ago here in France by writing that phi of x is equal to the integral over space. So now, let me draw something. I have a source, and I consider a point inside the source I call y. I consider a point x outside the source. I compute the solution phi of x outside the source as a function of the density in the source. So I just have the Poisson integral, which is rho of y divided by 1 over x minus y. Okay? But now, this is a function of x and y, where y, the origin is here. I take the origin here. If x is outside the source, this distance y is smaller than 1 compared to x, the ratio of y, the distance compared to x, and therefore I can expand this in a convergent series in powers of y. It's an analytic function, and then it converges in this domain. But when I do that, what do I get? Actually, so let's write this. I have Taylor's theorem, which says that 1 over x minus y, you see, the advantage of this notation is that things become very simple. 1 over x, I mean, they look simple. 1 over x minus y can be written as sum over L of minus, because there is a minus here, to the L, y to the L,
dl of 1 over x. Okay. This is as if y was, you know, one variable, and you were expanding 1 over x minus y, except that this means a tensor with L indices, this means a repeated derivative, but this is correct. This is Taylor's theorem with L variables. And if I plug, sorry, if I insert, it's more elegant, this thing here, I will get that phi outside the source, so now I take it outside, is equal to sum over L from 0 to infinity of minus 1 to dl over factorial L times m hat L dl of 1 over x. But this is modulus of x is what I called before r. So this dl, this is dl of r. So it's the same, it's exactly what I was writing here. This thing here is this thing. And therefore, the coefficient I have in front is what I was calling before the field multiple moments, what parametrizes the field in multiple expressions. But now it is expressed in terms of the source. So I have the result I wanted. The result is that the field multiple, which is a symmetric tensor ML, is when I consider this, I put the coefficient, then you find that this is the usual well-known formula. It's d3y inside the source, because the this has compact support in the source, times yl. You see, this is the simple formula. We all know the multiple moments is the integral over the source of the density times, I repeat y1 for the dipole, yi for the quadrupole, yi, yj, but I take away the trace. It's just generalization for any l. Okay. And if l equals 0, I have what? The total mass. If l equals 1, I have the dipole moment of the source. If l equals 2, I have the quadrupole moment of the source. Okay. Now, let me make the connection between these expansions and Legendre polynomials and YLMs, the generalized things. Actually, there is something nice that I discovered when reading Maxwell. Because in the book of Maxwell has very nice insights about physics in general and multiple expansions. And why are they called multiples? Because actually what Maxwell does, he says, let's consider the general solution of Laplace equals 0, which decays at infinity. And he's saying the general solution will be obtained as follows. I take on the sphere, okay, each vector, okay, you take a first vector that you call d for dipole, okay, because what is a dipole? A dipole is an infinitesimal displacement between a minus charge and a plus charge, so it is a direction, okay, let me normalize this direction to something. So it defines also on the unit sphere, it defines where this dipole pierces the sphere, so it defines a point on the sphere. But now let me take other points, okay? So I take points on the spheres, which means vectors, d1, d2. For instance, they can be unit vectors, but we can put a norm later, okay? I take L of them. Then Maxwell explicitly says that modulo, okay, I take this factor, I take the first vector, I make the product, so it's a tensor product of L vectors, okay? I contract this with the Lth derivative of 1 over R, okay? This is harmonic, okay? So this is also an harmonic function, which depends on what? Okay, first, if I write it, it is 1 over r l plus 1, just by dimensional analysis. Therefore, on top of this, I will have a polynomial which depends on L vector, but a polynomial in n, the unit vector on the sphere. Okay? If I take all those vectors coincident at one point, so I take the same vector, this polynomial is the Legendre polynomial, where the z-axis is the Legendre axis. Okay? But if I take them arbitrarily, I get a polynomial. For instance, if I take L equal 2, you find that P2 for two vectors, if you do the computation, is 1/2 of 3 d1n, the scalar products d2n minus d1 d2, the scalar product of d1 and d2, which is the contraction of the tensor product of the two vectors times 1/2 of 3 ni nj minus delta ij. And now you see immediately the 3 minus 1, this is the Legendre polynomial if the d are in the z-axis, okay? But here you have a generalized Legendre polynomial which depends on vectors on the sphere. And now if you take an arbitrary, let's take all the vectors, unit vectors, simply so that they are on the sphere. So on the sphere, I choose L points, okay? 1, 2, 3, L. How many data do I have? One point is two coordinates, theta phi, on the sphere. If I take L points, I have 2L continuous parameters here. I put a magnitude in front, okay? A normalizing factor, okay? So it gives 2L plus 1 arbitrary parameters. So here I have an object which contains 2L plus 1 arbitrary parameters, which is harmonic, which satisfies, the full thing is harmonic. And then, actually, this is the most general solution of Laplace equation. And that's the way Maxwell was parametrizing a multiple. And that's why they are called multiples, because they are made of poles, L poles, okay, on the sphere. Now, what is the link between this and the usual YLM? So I just said quickly that if I take all the vectors, so let me explain things. What is confusing about YLMs is that when you have multiple expansions like that, you parametrize them by a symmetric trace-free tensor without writing this tensor. This tensor is a general tensor in a linear space, okay? This linear space has 2L plus 1 dimension because there are many conditions. But you don't need to write it on a basis. It's like when you do geometry, you can say, I have a vector V. You don't need to say, I have Vx, Vy, Vz with explicit numbers. Okay, you work abstractly. And the STF approach is like that. Why? If you say, no, I want to express things in the x, y, z axis, okay, then you choose a basis. This is the YLM thing. The YLM business is to choose a basis of the possible symmetric trace-free tensors at rank L. And the way you choose the basis is the following, is the Maxwell way. You take L poles on the sphere, but what are these poles? They are obtained in the following way. First, you have to choose axis Ex, Ey, Ez in space. So you'd say, okay, let me take X, Y, Z axis. Now, let us call Ez, you call E0, just for fun, because 0 means it has zero helicity in the sense that if I make rotations in the XY plane, the Z axis does not move, okay? So as representation of the subgroup of rotation in the two-dimensional plane, this is eigenvalue 0, okay? Why? If I want something which is a good eigenvector of the rotations in the XY plane, I need to have complex combination, which traditionally are defined like that. So it is now Ex plus or minus I Ey over square root of 2. This is just a normalization. This is also a normalization for historical reason. Now the plus and the minus is in the same order as here, while before they were not in the same order. Okay. So this is a vector, it's a complex vector, which is null, by the way. These vectors are such that they are isotropic, E square. But still, formally, you can consider, by using these formulas, that a YLM is obtained by taking L pole. You use these formulas, you see. You define a solution of Laplace equation by acting on it, because mathematically, this is, mathematicians, you know, would say a vector is a differential operator, actually. Okay. And therefore, I take vectors acting on 1 over r successively. So you take the vector Ez, you take it, so let me check this. Ez, which I call E0. You take it L minus M times, and then you take the vector E plus 1, that you take m times, which means that I write this formula, and here l minus m of these vectors are E0, and m of them are E plus 1, okay, in this formula. It defines a solution, an harmonic solution. This thing is proportional to, so let me write this, this object when I act this way, so this differential operator. Even mathematically, I could say I act with E plus 1 as a vector, as a differential operator m times, okay, and E0 l minus m times. I act on 1 over r, and modulo a coefficient that I don't want to write here. This thing is ylm of theta phi, okay, the usual spherical harmonics. And but in explicit form, ylms means it is an object which is a polynomial with L indices in NL, okay, with my notation. So the conclusion is that the usual YLM, they define, and how many of these do I have? I have 2L plus 1, because M goes between minus L and plus L, okay? That's the usual thing. I've, by the way, written the formula for positive M. One needs a formula with minus 1 for negative M. The point I want to make here is that the usual YLMs, if you open a textbook, Landau-Lifshitz, or the book of Michele Maggiore, you will find definition of YLMs. These things are, can be written as polynomials like this, like Legendre is a polynomial in N, contracted with the vectors in front. Therefore, this defines a symmetric, this thing is a symmetric trace-free tensor, and the set of 2L plus 1 for given L and M varying between minus L and M, so I have 2L plus 1 tensors, symmetric trace-free tensors, and these tensors is a basis. It's an orthogonal basis with respect to the integral over the sphere of the set of independent symmetric trace-free tensor in this 2L plus 1 dimensional space. And therefore the conclusion is that what is confusing with when you expand multipolar expansion in YLM is you are doing two things. You are expanding intrinsically in terms of representations, but you are also computing the components of this representation in a specific basis, which actually confuses the thing more than I find personally. Now, now let's go, this was Laplace equation, okay, and Poisson equation. We are interested in Einstein's equations. But I have explained this at length just to say how you use this technology to compute the multipolar expansion for linearized gravity for Einstein's equation. And let me repeat, it's a surprising fact that this was first done by me and Bala Ayer here in 91. It did not exist correctly in the literature and not in the, there was something which was wrong, and not in STF tensors. And this, why do I explain this? Because this multipolar expansion in linearized gravity is the basis of what is used for nonlinear gravity, okay? And all the calculations in the Blanchet-Damour-Ayer formalism done there have been done using the nonlinear version of what I'm going to present. I should not have erased this. So what I have explained for the Laplace equation, the Poisson equation, now we do for Einstein's equation. Okay, but first we have to do it for the, how is it called, the Klein-Gordon or the, for the relativistic massless scalar field, that is to say, let us consider the equation which is the relativistic Poisson equation, which is this equal minus 4 pi s tx, okay? So you take, I should not have erased this, in space-time, you take a source which is specially with specially compact support, so it persists in time, but it moves in space. But, sorry, it does not move on average on space. It is zero here, non-zero along a tube like that. Okay. Now, how do you? And we are interested in the retarded solution.
Okay, the retarded solution is obtained by phi is the retarded Green function convoluted with the source S, where the retarded Green function as a function of 2 points in space and time. So the retarded Green function is a function of a point in space-time here, which has a time component and a space component. And I'm going to have here, so this is a field point, this is a source point, okay? The Green function, Tyy, is equal, as everybody knows, is the retarded potential. It is delta Tx minus Ty minus, for the retarded thing, x minus y divided by c, divided by x minus y. So you have the usual Poisson 1 over r, but you have the retarded propagation at the velocity of light. We are in a 4 space-time dimension. This is well known. Now, therefore, what you want, you have a source here. So you compute this convolution. So you say, OK, the integral will be over the light cone, so I will have an integral here. But now, how do I expand in multipoles? What does it mean, multipoles? But remember, multipoles, it's written here. For the Laplace equation, it was very simple. Multipoles were a sum over repeated special derivative of the basic harmonic function 1 over r, okay? Can I write immediately what will be the form of a general multiple expansion? Yes, because outside the source, phi as a function t of x will be a sum over L from 0 to infinity. I can conventionally, it's convenient to keep the same. This is just a numerical factor, but this way it takes away numerical factors later. Of what? I want now something which is a solution of D'Alembert equals 0, which is now emitted by the source. So it is like a function. What is the basic function of T and R emitted by the source? We all know this. This is f of t minus r over c divided by r. Okay, this is a retarded wave emitted by a line, okay? So if I consider this and I take L special derivative of this, this is a solution of D'Alembert equals 0. If I put L indices here, it's still a solution. And therefore, I expect that the general solution will have multipoles defined by symmetric trace-free tensors. So f is something with L indices and symmetric trace-free, but it's also a function of time, and I write it as function of t minus r over r. Therefore, it is a solution of what I want. And now, first you prove that this is true, that is to say, the retarded solution that you compute by the Green function can be expanded this way, but the important thing is that you want to compute what is FL in terms of the source, okay? Which is the analog of the formula here, which was saying that the ML was the usual multipole, okay, integrated over the source. But now everything is time dependent, so it becomes a non-trivial calculation. And this is the calculation which was first done by Luc Blanchet and myself in 89. And one gets a simple final answer, but not as simple as the one above. There is a small trick, okay? And the answer is FL is a symmetric tensor with L indices, which is a function of one variable, okay, time. And actually, I will write first a formula which is the same as this one. FL is an integral over the source, d3x, by the way. Now, just for simplicity, I call y, I call x, but x is y, okay? I am in the source. Of some function, s bar L, which is a function of t and x, times xl. So it's the same formula as this one. I take a multiple moment, like the quadrupole moment, symmetric trace-free, but I have a certain source, sl, okay, which is not s itself, so it's not the source rho, it is slightly modified. But what is s bar L? So I have this formula, and s bar L, which is a function of t and x, is equal to an integral between minus 1 and plus 1 of over an auxiliary variable z of delta L of z times the source, the one that appears here, the real source, okay? But computed at time t plus z x over c x. Where here you have an average between, so you are, instead of computing things at time t, the variable here, t prime, deviates from t by something which is between minus r over c and plus r over c. The physical reason is that indeed, if I compute this at time t and time t is here, I have some fluctuations around, okay, which is the time travel time in the source. So I need to average over travel time in the source. And the kernel, delta Lz, is a function whose integral over z is equal to 1. So delta, this is an average. The integral delta L of z dz between minus 1 and plus 1 is equal to 1. Why is it called delta L? If you take L very large, this function delta L looks like a delta function, in the sense like for large L, it is concentrated around 0. It still varies, I mean, it goes between minus 1 and plus 1. The area here is 1, but it gets concentrated around z equals 0. And the explicit formula is very simple. There is a numerical coefficient, which is 2L plus 1 double factorial divided by 2 to the L plus 1 factorial L. It's just coefficient. Times 1 minus z squared to the power L times the step function of 1 minus z squared, which means it is 0 outside this interval. So you see, it decays exponentially when z is different from 0 by 1 minus z squared to the power L, when L is large. Okay? So this is a very convenient formula which allows to compute explicitly the relativistic multiple moments for the massless scalar field. And it is this formula that now you apply for solving. You want to solve essentially the same equation, except that you are going to add indices, for instance. If you want to solve Maxwell's equation, you write this, but you put an index. You say, ah, the source is j mu, the current for vector. If I solve Einstein's equation, I will have two indices, okay? Mu nu, okay? But then, for each solution, I can use this formula. But there is something else, okay? So let me discuss this quickly. Yes. Maybe let me discuss it. So in the paper with Bala, we did it for electromagnetism and gravity. Let me do immediately gravity because I have 15 minutes left. And so let me put this up.
Just a question. Yes. In that formula, when you apply the derivative at given L, you have all the powers of 1 over L, 1 over R.
In which formula?
In the one in which the R is inside the FL. And all.
Yes, sorry. When you differentiate this, the maximum power is 1 over R to the L plus 1. And the minimum is when you differentiate in time this. But indeed, this is why this thing is a wave, because it has a component. When r goes to infinity, the leading term, the term which decays most slowly, is the 1 over r term. The 1 over r l plus 1 is the one that decays fast. And therefore, at infinity, this is a 1 over r wave, which contains the L time derivative of Fm. And this is what in the old days Poincaré and Langevin would call the acceleration wave. It's the wave which is 1 over r, which radiates. It's the wave which radiates. So this is a wave also. It's not only a multiple in the static sense, okay? It is a radiative multiple. Now, when you apply this to gravity, so you have to use Einstein's equations, the linearized Einstein's equations. If you use these equations, and as I explained before, if you go to harmonic gauge, remind you that I define h bar mu nu is h mu nu minus 1 half of h eta mu nu. The harmonic gauge is d nu of h bar mu nu equals 0. And in this gauge, Einstein's equations, if I write it in terms of h bar mu nu, is D'Alembert of h bar mu nu is minus 16 pi g over c4 t mu nu. Okay? So you have exactly a separated wave equation with source. So I can apply this formula immediately. But if I do that, what do I get? I get that h bar 0, 0 has as source a scalar t 0, 0. So I can write this formula for, now let me sketch things. So h bar 0, 0, I will write as a sum over L of dL of something which would be like FL of t minus r over r, where this FL is obtained by this formula with the t 0, 0 replacing the source S, okay? And this FL will be given as a function of the source by this formula, where S is t 0, 0. Okay, so it looks like something, a wave generated by t 0, 0. But if I do the same formula with h 0 I, I do it first naively, saying, okay, I just put indices. There are indices, they are there. It's 1, 2, 3. Okay, it's just a number. So I can write the same thing. I have again a formula where I have a dl. But now the object which is here will have l indices like that. But there will be an extra index I coming from the source, because the source S now will be t 0 I. Just I have an index which goes over, okay? So I will have something which contains one index I and L, function of t minus r over c, divided by r, okay? I do it again for hij. I have a sum, but now I have the source is tij. I have two indices, but therefore I have the same formula, but I have hij, L, t minus r over c over r. Okay. So you could say, ah, okay, so I have expressed the solution of Einstein's equation in a sum of multiples. They look like multiples, but they are not multiples, because the definition of a multiple is an irreducible representation of the rotation group. But now, what is irreducible, as I said, is a symmetric trace-free tensor with L indices. Consider this object GIL. Now, in quantum mechanics books, you would say, I mean, as a tensor, this is the tensor product of a vector, I mean, as an element of a space, times something which is a symmetric trace-free tensor with L indices. Okay, so tensor, I have added an index. In quantum mechanics term, or sorry, in mathematical term, this belongs to the representation D1 tensor DL. DL was a reducible transformation, but now I make a tensor product. It's not irreducible anymore. So I need to decompose this thing in irreducible tensors. But technically, what does it mean? It means simply, I have this object, and I want to write it as a sum of building blocks made of symmetric trace-free tensors. And this is easy to do by hand, because, for instance, you can write that this is, first I take the symmetric trace-free projection, so it's part of the thing, and then the rest will be what? The rest, you find, can be expressed in terms, what are the invariant tensors of SO3? I have two invariant tensors of SO3. I have the Levi-Civita tensor, and I have delta ij, the metric. So you build from these objects invariant building blocks that you can make with these objects, and you symmetric trace-free them, and then you reconstruct the object. So at the end, you can write, I don't have the formula written here, but you use the epsilon here. You make an intermediate object, which, yes, I should have said that. In quantum mechanics, we know that this thing is dl plus 1 plus dl plus dl minus 1. What does it mean in symmetric transfer? It's the usual formula for the spin addition, okay? And therefore, what it means is that this object, which is not irreducible, should be the sum of a tensor which has L plus 1 irreducible, so it should be a symmetric trace-free with L plus 1 indices. It should contain a part which is made of a tensor symmetric trace-free with L indices and a part with L minus 1 indices.
the object with L minus one indices is very easy to guess. It is obtained by taking the trace. I have an object here which has L indices here and one index here. If I make a trace, which means I take the I leave L minus one indices alive, okay? And one of the L indices, I call it S, and I make the sum over S. So if I take a trace between, okay, let me write it. If I have G, JK, for instance, okay? If I take the trace GSSK, I have a vector, which is, if I have one more index, I have a tensor. As this was symmetric trace-free with respect to these indices, this is again symmetric trace-free with respect to the indices that I have not traced. So this operation immediately gives me an object which belongs to this space. Okay? Now, to get an object which belongs to the intermediate space, I need to use the epsilon, because the epsilon, you contract things, but you have three indices, you contract two, so finally you have L indices that you started with. And therefore, there is an explicit formula that I don't write here, which is a contraction between G, some indices here, like you have A, B, you take A here, a B here, you have L minus one, you have an I, and then this I, you call it IL again, and you take symmetric trace-free between this and this, and you put epsilon in front, and then the last object is this one, which is an object with just L minus one indices, and you put delta IJ, I1, I2, and then this thing has finally L plus one indices like this guy, okay? So it's just a simple algebra, but this abstract thing is very concretely realized this way. And let me write the final result. The final result, I have 5 minutes to write the final result, which is what I wanted to get to, is that at the end, here, I had many multiples. So remember, when I had a scalar field, the multiple expansion contained an infinite sequence of multiple moments. Like there was a monopole, a dipole, a quadrupole, but just one dipole, one quadrupole. Okay, I had a sequence, a skeleton like that of the object. Here, I have a monopole F0, I have a dipole, I have a quadrupole coming of the F type. Here I have again gi, which is a vector, I have gij, so I have many objects here. Actually, most of these objects you can gauge away, that you say. Now you remember that Einstein's equations, these equations, they are still invariant under a coordinate transformation if I respect the harmonic gauge, which means xi mu equals zero, okay? But what is the general solution of delta xi mu equals zero? It is again a multipolar expansion. So I can use, I can decompose the general solution of this in multiples. It gives me four types of multiples because I have an index here, 1, 2, 4. So this way I can suppress, I can gauge away a lot of these multiples. And at the end, you find that the general solution of Einstein's equation can be written in terms only of two types of multiples, which are the so-called mass multiples and the spin multiples. And let me finish by writing the explicit formula. So h bar 0, 0 is 4g over c square, sum over L. You keep this just so that in the Newtonian approximation, these are the usual multiples of the source. It's just a normalization convention. It's dl of il of u over r, where u means t minus r over c, where now these capital letters denote the field points, plus gauge term, so plus d xi, you know, d0 xi 0, a general gauge term, which has itself multiple expansions. H bar 0 I has minus 4 g over c cube, sum of minus L over factorial L d L minus 1, so it's a repeated derivative with L minus times. The time derivative of this multiple, so this multiple appears here not differentiated in time, and here it appears with L indices this way, divided by R. Then there is an extra multiple which appears, C cube, sum over L minus L L divided by L plus 1 factorial L epsilon I A B D A L minus 1 J B L minus 1 of U over R. Let me write and then I will plus gauge term plus D0 xi I plus DI xi 0. And then HIJ bar is equal to plus 4G over C4 sum minus L over factorial L D L minus 2 second derivative of the this multiple, the same object with IJ L minus 2 of U over R. And then there is a term with A, sorry, AG over C4 sum of minus L over L, L plus 1 factorial L. I refer for the paper to have the correct formula, but just let me write epsilon ABIJG dot derivative B L minus 2 U over R, okay? Which means that I have expressed the general solution of linearized Einstein equation outside the source in terms of two sequences of multiple moments, IL and JL, okay? And then you have explicit formulas that I will write here for these multiple moments as a function of the source. And this was the main result of this paper with Bala. And you will recognize what they mean. So anyway, it's a theorem. It's just a result. ILU is the IL multiple is an integral over space, over the source. There is the integral over Z because there is always this delta L of Z. And then here you have something. Let me define. It's convenient to define the sum T00 plus TSS over C square. And then sigma I is T0I over C. It's just a notation, the sum of T00 and the trace. Because the main term here you find is delta L, which is delta L of Z that I have defined here, XL, which means multiple moments of what source? Of the source sigma taken at the same argument that appeared here. The argument has to be shifted by Z. So I indicate this by a tilde, but this means this formula. So this gives the usual Newtonian multiple moments when I neglect 1 over C, because they are, I can expand this as 1 over C. But I have more terms now. 4 times 2L plus 1 over C squared, it's a 1. L plus 1, L plus 2L plus 3, sorry. Yes, I remember, 2L plus 3. Delta with index L plus 1, it's a function of Z. X A L time derivative of the T 0 A plus 2 L plus 1 over C 4 L plus 1 L plus 2 L plus 5 delta L plus 2 X A B L second time derivative of TAB, okay? Source, and then I will not write the full thing, but you have a similar formula for GL of U, except I will write just the first term. It's STF projected over L, and the first term is delta L X L minus 1 epsilon IL AB XA sigma B, okay? Minus a term with delta L plus 1, okay, time derivative of TBC. Okay. So these are explicit formulas which, if you take something which is static, which does not depend on time, these formulas reproduce the usual multiple moments. What happens here is that here you recognize, what is this thing? This is the cross product, it is XA. So it is X cross T0I as a vector, okay? But T0I is the momentum density locally. So this thing is X cross P,
It's the amount of momentum in a small volume. So this is the angular momentum density. So this object is a multiple moment of the angular momentum density. That's why these objects are called J. If I take only one index, this quantity is the total angular momentum of the source. If I take more indices, it is a multiple moment associated to the current of momentum. So that's why it's called a spin moment. If the source rotates, I have moments of this type. If the source does not rotate, I have only mass type moments. Okay? Okay, let me stop here. So this is the basis for being able to compute in nonlinear general relativity, but now I was in linearized gravity, but this is the starting point, okay, of the wave. I've written the explicit formula which gives the decomposition in irreducible representation of SO3 of the general wave emitted by a source in linearized gravity. Okay, thank you for your attention. Everybody's dead. Yeah, Natalie.
But you can choose your gauge now completely.
Yes, so I am in harmonic gauge here. This is an harmonic gauge transformation that can gauge away. And then you go in what is called a canonical harmonic gauge, where the metric is only expressed in terms of two types of multiple moments, mass and spin. Yes.
But this doesn't change your...
No. This, all these things are, the technical thing to compute these, they are obtained by changing the gauge. No, these are gauge invariant objects. Yes, sorry. These multiple moments are canonically fixed. They express the physical degrees of freedom which are radiated. For instance, later we will find that the amount of energy and angular momentum emitted by the system is a function of these two types of multiple moments. These are physical things. They generalize the lowest order quadrupole formula of Einstein, which Einstein said, at lowest approximation, the wave is a quadrupole object, and the energy flux is a function of this quadrupole. Here we are saying the wave is decomposed in mass quadrupole, mass octupole, etc., and also spin quadrupole, spin octupole, and the energy loss is the sum of square of derivative of the mass octupole, mass quadrupole, spin, etc. They are physical objects.